we're discussing about caches. So today we'll try to quantify the performance of cache and try to address the system components that affect cache performance. So this is a basic equation that dictates average memory access latency. 1 minus miss rate multiplied by hit time plus miss rate times miss value. So that's a basic equation. So this much of fraction you hit, you multiply that by the time taken for each hit, and the remaining one accounts for the time spent on this. And overall execution time can be now framed as busy time plus memory stall time. So busy time essentially is a time where a processor is doing something useful. Memory stall time is a time when a processor is stalled on memory. So here I also include other stall times in the busy time. So there could be other stalls also. For example, you may have shorter your function memory stalls for which the machine has to stall. So busy time is determined mostly by ILP exploited by the processor. So when I say exploited by the processor, that of course depends on how rich the processor is in terms of machineries for extracting ILP. So how many function memories it has and all other things. If it has a full bypass network or not. If it's a partial bypass, then there will be other stall cycles. If it doesn't have any bypass, there will be many internal stall cycles. So they are not part of the memory stall time. Okay, they're all part of this. So cache misses become more expensive as processors get faster. Why is that? So I have a fixed memory module, and I have two processors. One runs at 2 GHz, one runs at 4 GHz. And I'm saying that for the 4 GHz processor, the cache misses. So cache misses become more expensive as processors get faster. Why is that? So I have a fixed memory module, and I have two processors. One runs at 2 GHz, one runs at 4 GHz. And I'm saying that for the 4 GHz processor, the cache misses are relatively more expensive. Why is that?
More time is spent while waiting for cache misses.
More time?
More time and percentage of time. More percentage of time is because the useful time is reduced.
Okay, right, exactly. So if you look at this one, if you increase frequency in the processor, this is likely to go down. Okay. So your portion of memory stall time is going to increase because this is constant. Okay. If you change the processor, this is going to remain constant, this particular time. Okay. Whereas this is going to go down gradually. Okay. So in the limit, you'll be only having memory stall. The limit, of course, that's not possible really to nullify this completely unless you have a super fast processor which takes no time to do the instructions. That's not possible really. And the question is that when you're really talking about this, it often becomes important to measure the memory stall time. For example, if you're analyzing a particular program, a computer architect routinely tries to quantify the execution time into these two parts. Okay, the question is how do you really measure these things? So even if I give you a simulator, the problem is that in an out of order issue processor, there are many things happening concurrently. So there may be a memory request outstanding currently. Cache has taken a miss, it has already gone out to memory. In the meantime, processor may be doing something else. Maybe actually working on some independent instructions. So how do you really quantify this particular component? That's very important. Then only you'll be able to understand the bottlenecks in your system. So how do you do this? Any idea? Is the problem here why this is a question? Right? Because there may be certain memory operations, latency of which is partially overlapped with something useful. So how do you quantify? Okay, so I'll give you one answer to this, although this is not the only answer. You could come up with other techniques also. So usually, what computer architects do is that they look at the commit stage of the pipeline, when the instructions are leaving the pipeline, the last steal of the pipeline. And let's suppose that you have a commit width of W. You can retire W instructions every cycle. Right? So then what we say is that if you can retire at least one instruction in a cycle, that's a busy cycle. If you cannot retire any instruction in a cycle, that's a stall cycle. And the stall cycles may come from various reasons. Now, a memory stall cycle in a cycle is a stall cycle when the commit stage could not retire any instruction. An instruction at the top of the ROD is a memory operation. So you know that the reason why you could not retire an instruction was because of a memory operation waiting at the top of the ROB, which could not be completed. For some reason, it stopped. So that's the memory stall time. And everything else is clubbed in the busy time. Okay. Is it clear? So it's a very simple way of accounting cycles. So you look at the retirement stage, and then you account every cycle as a busy cycle or a stall cycle. And among the stall cycles, you look at the top of the ROB. If that instruction is a memory stall, memory operation, that's a memory stall cycle. Right. Any question for this?
Sir, even if the you can retire one instruction when the commit plan is done, still it will be regarded as a busy cycle.
Yes.
The stall may be because we cannot commit the new instructions because of our memory.
Because you're saying that suppose in a cycle I retire n instructions, n less than W, and I could not retire more because n plus 1th instruction is a memory operation.
Yes.
You could go ahead and do that also. Right. But then the problem is that you might end up having a very small number here.
Okay.
Because it's very unlikely that you'll have a lot of cycles where you can consume the full commit band. Very unlikely. So you have to this is again, you know, I mean so here I'm saying is that if you can do anything, that's a useful cycle. Okay. If you could not do anything, then it's a stall cycle. Yeah, you can come up with other techniques also. The only point is that you should be able to argue your way out that this is correct. You should be able to convince yourself that this is correct. All right, so what I do now is take each of the components of this equation, right? Essentially, there are three terms. One is miss rate, one is hit time, and another one is miss penalty. And we'll see how to improve each of them, right? So as you can see here, the latency is essentially monotonically increasing function of each of these. All right, so the goal is to reduce each of these terms. All right, so let's see how to do that. So let's first look at miss penalty. So miss penalty is essentially the number of cycles that you spend on a cache miss, waiting for the data to come from the next level of the memory hierarchy. It could be main memory, it could be the next level of the cache. Okay. The first question is, which instruction is more affected? Loads or stores? Well, we have only two kinds of memory operations, right? Loads and stores. So which one is most affected by miss penalty? When I miss a store in the cache, when I miss a load in the cache, which one is more important? Load, why?
The load might be bringing in a value for a register in its operand.
Okay.
So if the cache miss occurs for a load,
right, exactly. So there may be other operations dependent on a load. Okay, right. So load value would be more critical for a process of the program. Whereas the value that is stored by a store instruction is not important. So stores actually terminate a chain of dependencies of the last instruction. Whereas loads usually is at the root of a dependence chain that it starts. All right. So you must execute the root of the dependence as early as possible. So the loads are most affected by miss penalty. So how to reduce miss penalty? So here are some simple solutions. You can have multi-level caches. We have already discussed that last time. You can have levels of caches in a hierarchy. And you can also derive an equation that looks very similar to this for a multi-level cache hierarchy. All right. So this is for a single-level cache hierarchy. That you have a miss rate of the cache, you have a hit time, and even miss penalty. You have two levels of cache, you can derive a similar formula, right?
Okay.
So essentially, your So this could be the L1 time. In L2, whatever L1 has missed will now have some portion of it will be hit in L2, and the remaining portion will go out as L2 miss rate multiplied by the miss penalty of the next level. Now, when you have a multi-level cache hierarchy, how do you compute the miss rate? That's a very important question. So you have essentially, let's suppose you have two levels of cache. Right? You have L1 and L2. Now, what is the miss rate on this hierarchy? Is it the L1 miss rate? Is it the L2 miss rate? What is it? So there are two terms that are important. One is called local miss rate, that is attached to a particular level of the cache. Right? So you can talk about the L1 miss rate and L2 miss rate. Okay? And the other one is called the global miss rate. That is, if you observe here, all right, the whatever misses you get, you divide that by, if you observe here, the total number of accesses into the hierarchy. All right? That's the global miss rate. Right? So misses go out here, accesses come in here, something happens in between. Whatever misses you see divided by the number of accesses is a global miss rate. And each level will have a local miss rate. That is, L1 miss rate will be basically the count of this divided by the count of this. All right. L2 miss rate will be this divided by this. And also people use misses per instruction. So if you are looking at the total number of misses here, you can divide that by total number of instructions. Okay. That's also a rate. Okay. It's only that you are not dividing it by number of accesses. Instead, you are dividing by the number of all instructions. Okay. So this is a better representative of performance. That is, you may have a very high miss rate. For example, your program has 100 load store instructions. Okay, right? So you're observing here, you observe that there are 100 accesses coming in, all right? And you observe here, you find that all 100 accesses actually miss, all right? So you may conclude that you have a 100% miss rate, all right? The question is it good or bad? Okay. That's not really enough to say whether it is good or bad. But this one will actually tell you how much it's going to impact the performance. Because what may happen is that maybe you're running a program which has 1 billion instructions, out of which only 100 are load store operations. Even if you miss all of them in the cache, it doesn't really matter much. Right? So this one gives you a very nice metric for estimating performance impact of misses, right? Misses per instruction. When you have a multi-level cache hierarchy, you have to decide whether they should be inclusive or exclusive or something somewhere in the middle. So you talked about inclusion last time. Let me introduce exclusion a little bit here. So inclusion was that you say that the contents of L1 is a subset of L2. All right? So that's what we said. That's the inclusion. Right? When you have exclusion, what happens is that, so essentially, the contents of L1 and L2 are disjoint. Right? So whatever you have in L1 will not be in L2. Right? How do you really guarantee it? So one way to guarantee it is that this is how processors implement exclusion. Whenever the processor accesses something into L1, okay, all right, if it misses in the L1, the request will go to L2 as usual. Right? L2 will be looked up. If it misses in L2, it will go to memory. All right. On the return path, it will not be filled in L2. It will directly be filled into L1. All right. Okay. When the block gets evicted from L1, it will be allocated to L2. All right. So you can see that all the time, the contents here is disjoint from the contents here. All right. Now what may happen is that the processor accesses something in L1, misses in L1, requests in L2. And the block is actually in L2. Okay, all right. So then what you do is you deallocate the block from L2 and copy it into L1. So that guarantees exclusion. Okay. What are the advantages and disadvantages of this? Inclusion versus exclusion. What is good about exclusion? compared to inclusion? Do you see any advantage of exclusion over inclusion?
More data can be stored in cache.
Say again?
More data can be stored in cache.
More data can be stored in the cache. Why is that?
Because both are different, so
exactly. So you can make full utilization of the cache space given to the processor. But there is no replication of data. So that's a major advantage of exclusion. It offers more effective capacity. Any disadvantage of exclusion compared to inclusion? So in inclusive, so this is exclusion. So when you have inclusion, what you do on the fill path, you fill into both, right? When you miss, when the block comes from memory, you fill both the L2 and L1, okay, all right? When the block gets evicted from L1, what do? Sorry? Well, it's evicted, so of course it's gone. So do you do anything extra? What if the block is dirty? You write back to L2. If the block is not dirty, you just drop the block. What happens here when you evict it from L1? Yeah?
It
has to be allocated in L2, right, at that time. So do you see any problem with that? On every eviction from L1, in this case, you have to allocate the block in L2. In this case, on every eviction from L1, only if it is dirty, you have to send the copy back to L2. Otherwise, you can drop the block. So which one is better? Or does it really matter? One more eviction? That's fine. So that eviction has taken place already in inclusion at the time of fill. So there is nothing extra going on in terms of evictions. The same. How much data is transferred between L1 and L2 in this case and in this case? You see a difference? On every eviction, the data has to go from here to here. It will require a much bigger bandwidth. Whereas here, only the dirty blocks will go from here to here. So in exclusion, that is a major problem, the bandwidth requirement between the levels of higher level. Okay. Even though it offers a larger capacity, it will eat into your bandwidth requirement. Okay, so you decide based on your design, whether to support inclusion or exclusion. We'll talk a little bit more about exclusion a little later. How do we resolve this particular problem, this bandwidth issue? It can be alleviated to some extent. So when you have a two-level hierarchy, how do you really design the second level of the cache, right? The L2 cache. Should it be a large L2 or a fast L2? We know that these two things cannot go together. Large ones will be slow. How about the block size and associativity? How do they compare against L1? What do you think? So let's go one after another. Should we have a fast L2 or a large L2? What's the option?
Large L2.
We should have a large L2, right? That's the whole point. It should be at least larger than L1 cache. Otherwise, there is no point in having a multi-level hierarchy. Okay, right? In fact, if you have an inclusive hierarchy, if your L2 cache is equal to the L1 cache, then your L2 cache will contain exactly the same data as the L1 cache. There won't be anything extra in there, right? Okay, so it should be at least bigger than your L1 cache in an inclusive hierarchy. However, in exclusive hierarchy, you can have the same size, actually. There is no problem as such. However, you probably want to have a bigger one so that you can hold more data. That's the whole point of having a multi-level hierarchy. How about block size and associativity of the L2 cache in comparison with L1? Should it be more than L1, less than L1, equal to L1? Why do we have blocks? I mean, why do we organize the caches in terms of blocks? We could just have, small walls. Why do we have blocks? What advantage do we get?
spatial time,
right? So bigger blocks offer you spatial time. You can bring large chunk of data in one shot and hope to use that in the future. So in light of that, can you answer this question? How should your block size?
Block size can be larger.
Can be larger. Should it be larger? Yes, it can be larger. It can be anything actually. I'm asking what should we do? What makes sense?
It should be larger.
It should be larger to get spatial information. Can it be smaller? Smaller than L1 block size? What is that? Yes? No? Why? Why can't we have a 64 byte L1 block size and 32 byte L2 block size? What's the problem?
Do you already have L1 size small enough so that L1 is fast?
Okay.
And L2 is larger.
We're talking about block size. Yeah, right. Okay. Yeah, L2 is larger. So? Why? I can have gigantic number of sets.
It will basically, if the block size is large, then L2 will be larger.
Not necessarily. The capacity of a cache is product of
entries. Given the number of entries.
No, why would you want to hold that constant? Number of sets. They can make it larger.
Smaller,
okay. There can be more misses again. Can you explain that a little bit? So take the example of L1 block size of 64 bytes and L2 block size of 32 bytes. How many L2 pieces do I need to solve to fill one in one cache block? How many L2 pieces do I need to solve to fill one in one cache block?
Two.
Two, right?
Yeah. Yeah. So they may be in need of two accesses.
Two accesses to memory, right? That doesn't make any sense at all. So it should be at least as large as the L1 block size. Now, do you see anything special about the exclusion? Do you need to consider something extra about block size? Can I have bigger block sizes in an exclusive hierarchy? L2 cache block size bigger than L1 block size. So we have just concluded that the L2 block size should be at least as large as L1 block size. I tell you that for exclusive hierarchies, they have to be. There is no other option. Why? I mean, they have to be equal in the sense that without introducing more complexity. Yes, you can have larger blocks. Can you explain why? Remember that on L2 hit, I deallocate the block from here and bring it to L. I copy it from L2 to L1. What happens if I have a 32 byte L1 cache block and a 64 byte L2 cache block?
Basically, discarding some portion of the junk. So they have to deallocate it from L2.
Yeah.
32 bytes of whatever is not needed.
Yes.
It has to be flushed back to
use. Yes, and something has to be done with the remaining data, right? Yeah. So either you introduce two tags per cache block to maintain status of both the halves, which essentially boils down to saying that the L2 cache block is 32 bytes. So for exclusive hierarchies, the simple solution is to have equal block sizes, right? Okay. So which is why if you go back to the history of AMD processors, which actually implement exclusive hierarchies, we find that the block sizes are all equal. Okay. Whereas if you go back to the history of Intel processors, you'll find that up to a certain point, up to like for example Pentium and so on, they had L2 block sizes bigger than L1 block sizes. Recently they have switched to equal block sizes for some other reason, which we may not discuss in this course. Okay? So the point is that for exclusive hierarchies, you cannot have bigger block sizes in the upper levels of the cache. Okay. What about associativity? What do you think? L2 cache associativity and L1 cache associativity. Why do we need associativity? What's the purpose?
Associativity improves the access. You can compare the tags.
Improves the access speed.
Like for the lower means like upper levels, it should be more associative.
No. Wait. First, let's answer the first question. Why do you need associativity? What is the purpose?
Can use this.
What kind of pieces?
Conflict.
Conflict. Right.
Means coalition.
Right, exactly. So, should we have more acidity in L2 cache or less? What do you call it? In theory, I can do anything, right? Pretty much anything. But practically, what makes sense? What do you really want?
Lesser associativity.
Why?
Because associativity means comparison also means we have to incorporate tag comparison.
That's right.
And so, if you are giving, say, full associative cache at the level 2, so the number of comparators will be more.
That's right.
So it will be more expensive.
That's right. Yeah, more as you make it more acidic, you become more harder. That's right.
Yes,
that's true. But what are you competing against?
The number of collisions will reduce as you go to.
Sorry, number of collisions will
reduce as you go to that because for the like two excesses which will match for L1, it is less likely that they both will miss in L1.
Well, if they are both conflicting in L1, likely that they both will miss because they will keep on flashing L1. So the purpose of L2 should be that they should not flash in L2 also, right? So you want to make it more associative, right? Okay. And also the point is that making a cache more associative normally slows it down. Okay. But the question is, what am I competing against? What is my next level? That's a huge latency. So anything you save is going to be beneficial for you. Okay, so that's your multi-level cache hierarchy. Other technique for reducing miss penalty is critical ward first. This is pretty much common sense. So critical ward is the ward within a cache block on which the miss actually happened. Okay. Processor wanted to access this particular ward within the cache block and miss the cache. Okay. So it naturally makes sense to send this particular ward first,
okay,
and then follow it with the other wards of the cache block. Right? Early restart. So this is very similar to critical ward first, except that you fetch in order.
Okay.
So start from ward 0 and go in sequence. But you start as soon as you get the critical ward.
Okay.
All right? So that's the early restart. You don't wait for the entire cache block to arrive. So what is the problem with this? The problem is that if the processor is going sequentially along the cache block, it will probably soon stall on the next ward of the cache block. Okay, so you have to take care of this actually. Right? So that's one problem. And the last solution for improving penalty miss penalty is prioritize loads.
Okay.
Because they've already concluded that loads are the biggest. Loads are affected most by miss penalty. So essentially what it means is that put stores in write buffers for write through cache and you send the loads first to the next level of the cache. And you could fill before spill in write back cache. So this essentially says that when the block comes in, what may happen is that you have to replace a block to make room for the new block. So you fill the complete the fill first before sending the write back if the emitted block is dirty. Okay. So that gives you that allows the processor to start early. Right? Yeah. Yes.
Can you explain this early restart?
Yeah. This one?
Yes.
Yeah. So you. Oh, this problem.
Yeah.
The problem is that so let's take an example, right? So let's suppose I have a 32 byte block. Okay. So it has 8 words, each 4 bytes, right? So let's suppose that, etc. So let's suppose that we miss here. So we want this word, right? So what early restart says is that you fetch in order, one after another, okay? And as soon as you get this word, you start the processor, okay? Now what if the processor is actually accessing this block sequentially? So immediately after this, it will probably stall here if it is not yet filled. That's what the problem is talking about. So what it's saying is that if the processor is doing a sequential access, this may not buy much. That's all it is saying. It will stall very soon. And that problem is there here also, in critical mode. It's the same problem. Any question on this?
In critical mode, associativity
will
be lesser?
Normally more. Much more.
Critical mode first, you will start fetching from that.
Yes, you normally start here, and different processors follow different protocols. The simple protocol is to wrap around and continue. Right. MIPS had a very strange ordering of words in the fit path. The first one will be this one, but it will not be really circular wrap around. You get some other ordering of the words. Any other question?
Okay.
So continuing on this penalty, so as we said here, we wanted to deprioritize the stores, right? So we put the stores in the write buffer, right, for write through cache, so that the stores will be, so in write through cache you will be writing all the values to the next level of the hierarchy, right? So from the buffer, the next level of the cache will pick up the values one after another and do the stores. So essentially what we're saying is that the L1 cache will not wait for the stores to complete. So it has other implications which we'll not discuss in this class, but this is what it is about, prioritizing loads. The question is, what about the write back caches? Okay. So this one actually talks about merging write backs. So what it's saying is that send writes to the same cache line together. Right. So why is it useful? Because it utilizes your bandwidth more effectively. Instead of sending words at a time, you can send a bigger chunk of data together. All right. So benefit depends on width of the data bus to the next level. Same technique can be used for gathering uncached writes. So these are the writes that do not go to cache. They go directly to the memory. You can apply the same technique for the memory bus utilization also, same thing. And finally, victim caching. This is very common in today's processors. What you do is, you put a small, fully accessory buffer containing last few evicted cache lines. So essentially what you're saying is that between L1 and L2, you put a small buffer, okay, which can contain a few cache blocks, all right? So whenever something is evicted from L1, you put it here. So the hope is that this block was evicted from L1 cache because of some conflict piece. Right? So it will be reused very soon from this buffer. Yeah, that's why you put it here. Okay. The victim cache hit swaps the replaced line with it. So whenever you hit in the victim cache, you would actually swap this line with the line here in the L1 cache. Okay? Alright. So it increases the effective accessibility of the cache. That's what it is actually achieving. AMD Athlon has an 8-entry victim buffer. Pretty much this is the size of the victim buffer, 860. So it's a small buffer. Usually effective for L1 caches, not for L2 caches. Because L2 cache is already having a large accessibility. Putting a small victim cache with it doesn't mind much. Whereas L1 caches are normally small accessibility, so putting a victim cache will help. Any questions for this? Not blocking caches, we have discussed this a little bit. So essentially the idea was that your cache should be able to handle multiple outstanding disks. Right? And we talked about this in connection with memory level barrels, how to improve that. Right? So these are also known as lockup free caches. Essentially make the loads non-blocking. Right? So what may happen is that the load instruction goes missing in the cache, so it will be sent to memory or the next level. In the meantime, the cache doesn't really stop. It continues to serve subsequent requests, the hits or misses. So it's easy to make stores non-blocking because there is nobody waiting for the store to complete. So you can just forget about the store pretty much. It's not that easy for loads because there are instructions after it that are waiting. Okay? So you have to stall those instructions until the load is completed. Okay. Even though the cache may be able to handle other memory requests in the meantime. Okay. So it allows hits under misses and misses under misses. You need a table to remember outstanding requests, one per line. This is called miss status holding registers or miss handling table. So this essentially holds the outstanding miss addresses, which are the addresses that are pending. Whenever a reply comes back, it will snoop the load queue to wake up the matching instructions. They can now retry. Okay. So there will be a bunch of load requests that are currently out there in memory, let's say. When one of them comes back, it will look up the load queue. Right. There will be at least one matching entry for sure, which is why the miss was sent. Okay. So this instruction now wakes up, and probably the next cycle it will retry in the cache. So this time, of course, it's going to hit. Why MSH is needed, given that the load queue already has the outstanding instruction? I just said that in the table here, but then I'm saying that the replies will come back and look up the load queue to find the instruction. Why do we need this table then? Could there be a situation where the instruction was not found in the load queue when the reply comes back? Sorry, say
again. In case of syscall, whenever you fetch in the pipeline, so suppose that the load instruction got caused.
Why? You're right, why should it get flushed?
If it was preceded by a syscall, and syscalls are executed in the right way.
Preceded by a syscall?
Yes, the instruction just ahead of it was syscall, and then
Okay, all right. So yes, that's possible. Anything else? Any other reason why it may get flushed? So I'm saying that this load is in the shadow of a syscall. And because the syscall executes when the pipe is empty, this load has to be cancelled. Yes, that's possible. But okay, anyway, so I assume that you handle syscall in that way. But usually the decoder will cache it already, that there is a syscall coming in. You don't even issue anything for it. Any other reason why the load may get, why the load may disappear from the pipeline? Sorry? What? What if this load is control dependent on a branch, if it predicts? So this load will probably be removed much before the data comes back, right? And for reasons for systems reasons, you cannot discard the data now. You have to fill the data in the cache, okay, because the other external environment has been told that you have the data, all right? So you cannot discard it anymore at this point. Okay, that will lead to inconsistency. So you have to fill the data in the cache, although you may not need it now, you know, right? And that's why this table is needed, to make sure that the cache is not receiving an unsolicited response, right? So this is primarily to make sure that this block was actually requested. Okay? So when the reply comes back, it will be matched against the table. Size of MSHR determines the degree of exposed memory level parallelism, and normally it is small, 8 to 16 entries. Right? Can compiler help in exposing more memory level parallelism? So you say that essentially memory level parallelism talks about situations where I have a large number of memory requests in flight in parallel, right? So that certain latencies can be overcome. How can the compiler help? Any idea? So memory level parallelism can be increased if I can cluster number of misses together, right? Number of cache misses together. I need to cluster them at one point. So the compiler can actually infer what's going to miss in the cache and what not. By looking at the source code, and it can actually reorder instructions. So it can cluster the load instructions together, which are likely to miss in the cache. Okay. So they'll all go out together and have a lot of overlap. Okay. Problems of increasing the size of MHT is essentially it will slow down your cache controller. Because every time a reply comes back, you'll have to search through the table to find out an entry. Okay, right? So it slows down the controller, it also consumes a lot of energy. That's why it does not get large. Effective way of hiding this penalty. So the basic idea is that I want to predict whatever the access in future and bring them into my cache so that by the time I actually access the data, it's already in the cache. Okay? So ideally, I will have a zero miss penalty. Okay? So there are two types of prefetching. One is hardware prefetching. These are pattern predictor assisted, and software prefetching, which are compiler assisted. Right? Before we even go into this particular, these implementations, there are a few common questions. First one is, would you like to prefetch into a dedicated prefetch buffer or directly to the cache? Right? Second question is, of course, what to prefetch. That's what these predictors and this compiler is trying to figure out. And when to prefetch. So let's take the first one. What do you think? Should I have a dedicated prefetch buffer on the side of the cache to put the prefetch blocks, or should I put directly into the cache? What are the pros and cons? Yeah?
The con is cache pollution.
Exactly. So you have to take care of certain extra things. So again, certain things we cannot discuss in this course related to multiprocessors. But there are, so whenever you put an extra structure, okay, there are certain extra things you have to do, right, which is better avoided. So today, all processors actually put the prefetches directly into the caches. Okay. They don't have any prefetch buffer. And as you have rightly pointed out, that actually puts pressure on the accuracy of this particular question. Okay. You better be correct. Otherwise, you'll be polluting your cache big time. All right. So these two are actually kind of linked. These two questions, that is, what to prefetch and when to prefetch. You may be 100% accurate, but if you prefetch too early, then you may be still polluting your cache because then you may be evicting something out of the cache which is still in use, okay, which is not good. All right. And if you are prefetching too late, then of course the whole point. Well, advantage of hiding this penalty is gone. Okay. So this is a very difficult thing to tune, when to prefetch exactly. And you'll find that usually the hardware prefetchers or the compiler would be conservative. That is, it will try to only hide a partial amount of latency. It will not try to hide the full latency by prefetching aggressively. And you can apply prefetching to both instruction and data. Nothing stops you from doing that. There are two types of prefetches, non-binding and binding data prefetch. So non-binding prefetches only prefetch a data block into the cache, whereas binding prefetches actually not only put the data in the cache, it also copies certain words into the register. So that essentially what it is doing is, you might have a load instruction which looks like this. With binding prefetch, this load instruction will be converted to a prefetch instruction. The data will be brought to the cache, and the word will be taken out and put in R2. Okay. All right. So this instruction will be gone actually completely. Whereas with non-binding prefetches, this instruction will remain there. Only thing is that you'll insert an extra instruction called prefetch, which will prefetch for this particular cache block. And the hope is that by the time the prefetch is completed, the load is still not there. Right? So when the load comes up, the data is already in the cache, it can take the word and put it out. Right? So that's the difference between binding and non-binding prefetches. So binding data prefetch is not done in any processor today. Again, because of things related to multiprocessors, somebody else may modify the data, which may not be reflected in the register. So that may cause other problems, correctness issues. So what kind of prefetchers today's processors use? One of the most popular one is a stream prefetcher, where essentially what you do is you divide your data address space into small chunks, right, called streams. And within each stream, you try to find out if the address is following a pattern or not. And the typical pattern that you look for is a stride pattern. That is, whether the addresses that you're accessing form an arithmetic progression or not. Right? So it tries to learn the common difference in that case, if that is the case. So a single stream stride prefetcher does not partition your data address space into streams. It just tries to learn the stride. Whereas a multi-stream stride prefetcher will actually partition the address space into multiple streams. And for each stream, it will try to monitor the arithmetic progression. So like, your single stream prefetcher will not be able to catch this one, for example. You will get completely confused. Okay. Because this is essentially a mix of two arithmetic progressions. Your multi-stream prefetcher will probably separate these two streams out, starting at A and B, because they'll probably belong to two different portions of the address space, and we'll learn both the arithmetic progressions correctly. Okay. And we'll prefetch independently both the streams. No, it doesn't know. No. So what if your stream size is such that A and B both fall in the same stream, then you'll not be able to separate these out. Yes, that's true. It doesn't know anything. It just creates streams by assuming an ad hoc size. One typical size that today's prefetchers use is a page. It tries to confine itself in a page. And within a page, it tries to look for strides. If A and B fall on the same page, then it will look like a single stream prefetcher, actually. It will not be able to separate these. So this is one of the simpler things that today's processors implement. There are many other sophisticated prefetchers. If you want to read up on that, I can give you papers. It's an extremely well-researched area with a huge body of literature. Hardware prefetching in general is harder than software prefetching because of the danger of polluting the cache. Because here, you do not have any vision of the program. Okay. You're just seeing a stream of addresses and predicting the future. So there's a very high chance of making mistakes here. Whereas in software prefetching, you can see the whole program, and the compiler is able to infer certain patterns with the accesses. Software prefetching needs support from the instruction set, for example, the prefetch instruction that I showed there, which was been unblocking. otherwise there is no point actually. So you should be able to launch this prefetch and forget about this instruction completely. So that the processor can keep going. What about prefetches on ROM path? I could have a prefetch instruction inserted on a path of a misconnected branch. What about these prefetches? Should I cancel them? What should I do? And what about prefetches that trigger TLB misses? It's possible, right? Prefetching is basically about looking ahead and running ahead. So maybe that you access a new page by prefetching. What do you do about those? So in this case, usually you continue the prefetch, hoping that the other path will be taken very soon. All right. This one is a little questionable because TLB misses are costly, and you are taking a TLB miss, believing a speculation. Prefetching is a speculation. You predict an address which may be wrong or which may be correct. And based on and believing that, taking so much of performance overhead may not make much sense actually. So depending on the design, you may either discard such prefetches or if you want, you can continue. In most cases, these prefetches will actually be discarded. Okay. Prefetches that trigger TLB misses. So one last point about miss penalty. So often what you do is, this is very common in programs, that is, you initialize a large data structure. Let's suppose you have an array, a large array. You initialize all elements of the array to zero, basically, in the program. So, so these are often called cold store misses. So first time you're accessing this array, so you cannot avoid these misses, it seems. So and this will be all stores. You'll be storing everything with a value. So if you observe, what is really happening is that you are writing to entire cache lines. It's not that you're writing to only a few nodes of the cache line. You're modifying the entire cache line. So then the question arises is, when I take such a cache miss, why should I break the cache line from memory? Because whatever is in memory will be overwritten completely anyway. So I should not be breaking it at all, right? I just allocate a block in my cache and just write the new value, that's it. To be able to do it, I need to know that yes, this is what the pattern is. So for this purpose, there are write hit instructions. They are in x86 and also they were introduced first in alpha 2.64. So what the compiler does is, whenever it catches such patterns, it will actually generate a write hit instruction, meaning that this entire cache block is going to be overwritten. So then, whenever such a cache miss happens, you don't go to memory. You just allocate a block, and that's it. So that nullifies the entire miss penalty. But it needs compiler assistance. Hardware cannot figure this out.
So how can the compiler know that the address is at the start of the block? It can be starting at the center of the block and trying to write through all the...
Yes. So usually, these patterns are caught when you have very simple data structures, like arrays.
But still in arrays, you can have the starting address at the center of the
block. Yes, you can have. Yes, in that case, compiler will not do it. But if you are allocating an array with a data line, for example, you know that it will be an aligned.
Addresses which are maybe with some alignment in virtual address space,
yeah.
They are translated into the same alignment in physical address space also?
Yes, they will. Because page offsets don't change.
So compiler can remove from virtual address whether addresses are aligned or not.
If you are using name align to allocate some data structures, yes, it will be aligned for sure. Yeah. Otherwise, the compiler won't know where according to the structure starts. Yes. So yeah, so to take advantage of this particular optimization, you may have to do sort of things in your program. Yes, that's correct. Okay, so just to remind you quickly what we're talking about. This was the average memory access latency equation. And we're trying to look at how to reduce each of the terms. There are three parameters in this. And we've already discussed how to reduce miss penalty, several solutions for that. So we're going to take up miss rate next. Okay. So what is miss rate? It's basically total number of misses divided by total number of accesses to a cache. That's miss rate. So before we go there, we first need to understand the reason for a miss, why a particular access missed in the cache. So for doing that, there is a classification of misses. Usually there are three types of misses. These are called compulsory or coded misses, capacity misses, and conflict misses. So these are usually known as 3Cs misses. Right? So the first question that arises is, given a cache organization, that is, if I tell you the ABC of the cache, so ABC of the cache, what does it stand for? A is the associativity, B is the block size, and C is the capacity. Okay. So if I give you the ABC of the cache, that completely defines the cache architecture. And suppose I give you a particular stream of addresses, and I ask you to categorize the cache misses into these three classes. How would you do that? Right, is the problem clear? So I have told you the ABC of the cache, and I'll give you a string of addresses. Right? So you feed this string into the cache, and some of these will hit, some of these will miss. Right? And I ask you to classify the misses into these three categories: compulsory, capacity, and conflict. How do you do that? Any suggestion? Because once you know what caused a particular miss, then you can think about the remedy, how to get rid of that particular miss. So let's start with the first one, that's the easiest one, the cold misses. How do you find out which misses are cold misses? What is the definition of cold miss, somebody? So it says that these are also called compulsory misses, which means you cannot avoid them. So what are these misses?
When you access the item for the first time.
Exactly.
So
exactly, yeah. So whenever you access a cache line for the first time, it will result in a compulsory miss, which you cannot avoid, whatever you do. So how do you categorize the misses? How do you find out the compulsory misses, given the ABC parameters and a string of addresses? So all you have to do is to find out the first size pieces. So how do you do that? What is the efficient way of doing it? What are the basic elements here? So you have to remember whenever whatever you have accessed in the past, and whenever you access something, you have to search through the whatever history you have maintained to figure out if this is the first access or you have already seen this cache log, right? If you have already seen this cache log, it's not a compulsory miss. If you haven't seen this cache log, then it's a compulsory miss. So what is the efficient way of doing this? What kind of data structure will you use? So I need to maintain a history which should be efficiently searchable. Yep. So I'll give you the requirements. You have to tell me your data structure to maintain this history. Yeah, somebody here.
Sorry?
Set is an abstract entity. What is the implementation?
Sorted array.
Sorted array?
So that you can search it in a...
What is a sorted array? Can you do better than that?
So binary search tree.
Binary search tree?
Yeah. I mean, implemented in an array.
But you have to balance it, right? To be able to get benefit out of it. Anything else? Which can you maintain in a reasonable way? hash table, right? So what is my hash key? In this case? The address, line address, right? Block address. So you may take the block address in a hash table and look up the hash table and find out, right? So in general that works much better than binary search tree, because you have to be balanced otherwise the binary search tree. Okay, so now whenever I get an address, I look up the hash table, find out if it is already there. If it is there, then it's not a tuple series. If it is not there, I insert it in the hash table. Okay, right? So that takes care of my code pieces. Is it clear to everybody how I count code pieces? Okay. What about the next one? Let's take up conflict pieces after this. How do you find conflict pieces? So I already separated code. Now I'm left with capacity plus conflict. I have to separate the conflict pieces for that. What is the definition of conflict pieces? Or rather, when can I get rid of all conflict pieces?
Fully associative hash.
Sorry?
Fully associative hash.
Yes, exactly. Given a capacity and block size, if I can make the cache fully associated, then I can say that for this particular capacity, I have no conflict pieces. So I can do that, right? So I know the ABC parameters. So all I have to do is, I design a fully associative cache, feed the address stream into this cache, calculate the total number of pieces. So what will be these pieces? These are cold plus capacity, right? Because conflict pieces are zero. I already have cold pieces, so I can calculate capacity pieces. And then what I do is, I actually simulate this actual cache with ABC parameters, feed the same address stream again, calculate the total number of pieces, and this will be cold plus capacity plus conflict. I already have cold and capacity, I can get the conflict pieces. Clear to everybody? How can I calculate this? Okay. So that tells you, given a particular program, I can find out how many pieces of each category that program has. Okay. We have already talked about victim caches. What kind of pieces does it target out of these three? What kind of pieces do we normally save if I have a victim cache? Why?
It's fully associated.
Yeah, so victim cache effectively increases your associativity. Okay. So that's why you save conflict pieces with the victim cache.
So once we have all blocks of the cache filled with certain, I've brought the certain block in all ways of my offsets.
Okay.
After that, all pieces will be conflictable.
No, why? That's exactly what I just explained, right? How to categorize, how to separate capacity and conflict. So in general, if you just look at a miss, it may look either way. It's very difficult to separate them out. You have to do that to separate them out. Okay, so now the question is how to reduce miss rate, right? So the first solution is to have larger cache blocks for a fixed size cache. Why does it reduce miss rate? So essentially what I'm saying is that I keep my C fixed, okay, and increase B. So I can actually do the following thing. I can keep my C and A fixed, okay, and increase B and reduce the number of sets, right? So I'll keep the capacity unchanged, and it says that it reduces the number of pieces, must be. Why? Why does it reduce number of pieces by increasing the block size? So if I increase block size, what am I doing? I'm bringing in more data in one shot, right? So if the application has good spatial locality, then comparing, let's say we are comparing a block size of x with a block size of 2x. Okay. If the application has spatial locality, then to bring in 2x amount of data, I would have taken 2 misses. Now I'll take 1 miss. Right? Okay. The problem is that this nice thing doesn't hold forever. Because now it may sound that, well, why can I make my entire cache a single block then? Right? It doesn't work in that way. Why? Why is that? So if you plot the number of misses with block size, it will look like this. Why is that? So what is happening exactly? I have a fixed associativity, I have a fixed capacity. I'm increasing the block size. So what is changing? What is decreasing? Number of sets is going down. So which means number of blocks mapping to per set increases or decreases? Must increase, right? Okay. So beyond a certain point, the conflict misses go up so much that you actually lose the advantage of having a spatial locality. Okay. You start losing that actually. Number of pieces actually start increasing. Because the completion per set is increasing as you increase the block size. Okay. Also, not all applications have perfect spatial locality. There will be applications that do not have very good spatial locality. So in those cases, increasing the block size beyond a certain point will actually start hurting. Because you'll be bringing in useless data into the cache. And plus, there is a bandwidth and latency effect also. Because to bring in more data, it takes more time. That's right. So you'll be consuming more bandwidth. Also, it will take more time to satisfy one piece. So that's the first solution, that is increasing B. Increasing C is the obvious solution to reduce the number of misses. If you have a larger cache, up to a certain point, number of misses will go down. But as you increase the capacity, the return will be diminished. Higher associativity, you can increase A, that will attack conflict misses. And in addition to that, there are compiler optimizations to reduce the number of misses. So let's take each of these at a time. Okay. The first one, that is code layout and target alignment in instruction cache, talks about reducing instruction cache misses. So let me try to explain what this is. So code layout essentially talks about reorganizing your code such that most frequently used instructions will be held in the cache. Okay, right? So most frequently used instructions will be clubbed together contiguously. Okay. So they can be held in the cache in a much easier way. Target alignment talks about, so addresses the following problem. Suppose you have an instruction cache block. Okay. There's a branch instruction somewhere in the middle. Okay. That jumps to another instruction cache block somewhere in the middle. Right. So what have you done? You have wasted trailing part of this cache block and the leading part of this cache block. So that essentially wastes your cache space. What target alignment tries to do is, it always puts the target of a branch instruction at the head of the cache block, so that the complete cache block is likely to be used with a higher priority. So this is what is happening here. So this is an instruction cache block. This one is a branch instruction. Okay. And the target falls in another cache block somewhere here. Alright? So this part of the cache block will be used, and this part of the cache block will be used. This is wasted. this and this. So how can you solve this? Well, the solution is that you can put branch instruction towards the tail of the cache block, and you can put branch targets towards the head of the cache blocks. Okay. So that will make sure that both the cache blocks are fully utilized. Okay. So this is what the compiler can do, but not always it's possible. Is it clear? Alright, so this relates to only instructions, not to use data. Okay, next, let's take an example. Loop interchange. So I'm initializing the two-dimensional matrix, right? Do you see a problem with this code? Looks perfectly fine, right? No, it's not. So it's going to be extremely poor performing. So the point is that if I assume that this C code, the C compiler allocates addresses in a row major fashion. What does it mean? That means matrix A will get addresses, contiguous addresses for the first row. And once the first row is done, the second row will start. Okay, that's how the matrix will be laid out in memory. Okay. So now if you look at this one, what am I doing? My matrix A. So let's suppose this is address 0, all right? And if I assume that my matrix is an integer matrix, so this is going to be what? This is 4 times n minus 1, all right? And here we'll start from 4n. Etc. Alright, so this will be all contiguous. Okay. 4 bytes each. Alright. Now if you look at the code, what does it do? It goes like this. So it accesses address 0, then 4n, then 8n, and so on. Okay. Now suppose n is very large. Let's put some numbers. Suppose n is equal to 1024. Okay. And suppose my cache block size is 64 bytes. So what can you say about these addresses? Which cache blocks they fall in? Will they be falling on the same cache block or different cache blocks, these addresses? Okay, so they will be falling on different cache blocks, right? So this is 4096, this is 8092, whereas my cache block size is only 64 bytes. Right? So they will all go to different cache blocks, and they will be all cache misses. All right. The question is, when I come back, so this one is the first element of my cache block, the first one. Okay. So one cache block is like this. It will contain 8 matrix elements. Okay. So I am done with the first column. Then I come back to the second column. So the question is this cache block still in my cache? If it is, then I'll enjoy a cache hit when I see the second column. Now, for this cache block to be in my cache, what should be my cache size? 1024 rows. Okay, should be able to hold 1024 cache blocks. Okay. Each cache block is 64 bytes. So if my cache capacity is 64 kilobytes, then I should be fine, right? It saves so at least. Okay. But I'm assuming that by these cache blocks will actually map to different sets or at least different ways of the cache.
Okay.
Alright. So you can easily find out that even with a very large cache, that's not going to be the case. Because these cache block addresses are very far apart. They will actually, very likely that they will all map to the same set. Okay, so this cache block will get evicted by the time I come back. So you're going to have pretty much 100% miss rate. So you can try this out actually. You can go back and run this program and measure the time.
Okay.
Make n very large so that you don't have, you know, you minimize the error of measurement. Okay. 1024 is a small number. Make it a very large value. Okay. So what this one is talking about is interchange the loops. So essentially what I do is I put the J loop outside and bring the I loop inside.
Okay.
So that's called loop interchange. And now my access pattern has changed. Now I go like this. The sequential access, what will be my cache hit rate? Okay, so I'll tell you what will be your cache hit rate. So there are 1024 times. So the total size of the matrix is 1024 times 4 bytes. Alright, okay. Divide that by cache block size, which is 64 bytes. So this many cache lines. I have exactly one miss per cache line. Okay, that's a code miss. Okay. So so how much does it come to? To be 16. Totally 16 misses out of how many accesses? I have 1024 times 1024 accesses in the matrix. Okay, right? So 2 to the 16 divided by 2 to the 20. 1 over 16 is going to be my miss rate. Okay. So every 16 access, I'll miss 1.
Okay, right?
Sorry, this was 16.
Yeah.
Okay. 16 elements per cache line. Okay, so that's loop interchange. Actually, you can try this out. You can go back home, run the two pieces of code without loop interchange and with loop interchange. Make n very large, measure the time. You'll see a gigantic difference in performance. Okay. Second one is loop splitting. So let's take one more example. It's most likely that you will find this code also okay. So often we tend to club initialization of matrices together, right, in a single loop if they are of same size. So what do you think about this piece of code? It looks perfectly fine, right? It's not, unfortunately. Can anybody guess what the problem is? So as the name suggests, I'll actually split these three in three different loops as opposed to clubbing them together. What is the problem with this piece of code? It is extremely common. We very often do this.
The address of CI will lie after the length of the array and the length of the A line.
Okay.
So that will be much far.
Okay.
And the same will be for C, that will be.
Okay. Why is there a problem? Why is that a problem? what happens if A, B, and C are very large? What will happen? Suppose the size of A is a multiple of your cache capacity. Size of B is a multiple of your cache capacity. Size of C is also a multiple of your cache capacity. You have a two-way set of CD cache. What will happen?
All three will map to the same set.
All three will map to the same set. Okay, then?
Then A and D will fill that two-way, and then C will come in and it will have a miss. It will have to evict one of these.
Okay. Which one will be evicted if I assume an error will be present?
A.
A will be evicted. So, after C, the access of A will come. Which one will be evicted? Okay. After C, the access of A will come, right? It's a loop.
Yes.
So,
and then they will get evicted.
They will evict B. Right?
Yes.
Access of B will come next. Which one will be evicted?
C.
What will be said? 100%, right? So, say if A, B, and C are large, it's recommended that you don't do this. Okay. It might seem that you are actually saving space in your program. It might seem that you have a compact code, but you are actually getting into trouble. Your code is going to take a very long time. Okay. Right. Split the loops, everybody will be happy. So that's what this transformation is, loop splitting. Right. This is a very simple example of loop splitting. There are many other compelling examples when loop splitting is applied. These are the common mistakes that people do, that's why I wanted to highlight this. And the last one is tiling for data. So here what you do is, this is a slightly more involved transformation that compilers apply. So let's take a very simple example. Suppose I want to transpose a matrix. So let's suppose this is my source matrix, and I want to transpose it into matrix B. Okay, so typically in a nested for loop, I would basically say Bij equal to Aji, right? Okay. All right, so B is equal to A transpose. Okay. So, however way you write the loops, whether it is I then J or it is J then I, one of the matrices will be traversed column wise, okay, either B or A. And we have already seen the problem of that. Okay. It can have a very high number of misses. The question is, how do I really solve this problem? Loop interchange will not solve this problem. So, you essentially what you do is you do a tile transpose. You divide the matrices into tiles, okay, both the matrices. These are called tiles. And what you do is you make the tiles small enough so that both of these tiles can fit in the cache, okay, all right, without conflicting. So then what you do is you transpose this tile into this tile. This into this tile, this into this tile, and so on. Okay. And notice that once I am done with the tile, I never come back to it actually. Okay. So if I can size the tiles so that they fit in the cache, I can enjoy maximum reuse and then throw away the tile and move on to a new tile. So this will give you that hit rate, roughly that hit rate, 1 over 16. Well, 1 over 16 miss rate. Okay. Because you'll get complete reuse of. So this is called loop tiling. This is called loop tiling. You can apply tiling to other constructs also. Any question on this? So of course, the examples that we talked about, like the interchange and all, by looking at the code, it was obvious that if I interchange the code, the program will still remain correct. Okay. In many cases, it may not be so. So there is a fairly involved transformation theory behind it, which can verify legality of interchange, legality of splitting, legality of tiling. Right? So these codes, we cannot really talk about those and cover those. Okay. And the last option for reducing miss rate is to come up with better replacement algorithms. So this one we have already talked about. Goal of the replacement algorithm is to minimize the number of misses. Right? And the simple observation here is that you should not be replacing blocks which are needed in the near future. Okay. Right? So, and the optimal policy is actually based on that, which essentially says that given the number of choices for replacement, you should replace the block which has the farthest reuse. So a gentleman called Laszlo Biladi came up with this algorithm in 1966 from IBM. So that's also called the longest forward distance replacement algorithm, LFD. So it looks at the next reuse distance of each of the blocks and replaces the one which is the largest reuse distance. Okay. So you must have seen this algorithm in your operating systems course, I believe. As optimal page replacement policy. Okay, so now we're left with the last parameter, that is hit time. So first question is, why is this important? So clearly one obvious reason why it's important is because of this equation, right? If I have a larger hit time, I'll have a larger average access latency. Right? So what is hit time? Hit time is the time taken to look up the cache and get the data out of the cache. Right? That's the hit time. So there are other impacts as well, which are not so obvious. Okay, so let's take a look at them. So let's go back to our pipeline that we discussed. So we have fetch, decode, allocate, issue, register file, execute, memory, write back, right? Okay, so this was roughly the pipeline that we discussed. So if you look at the load instruction, right? It computes address here, and these are the pipeline stages. I'm showing it as just one stage here. Is essentially your cache lookup stages. Okay, all right. So by increasing hit time, you'd actually introduce more pipe stages here. Okay. So let's first talk about a single stage, which means my hit time is just one cycle. All right. So now suppose we have an instruction that depends on this load instruction. So let's see what happens to this guy. So this instruction fetches here, decodes here, allocate. Now the question is, when does it issue? If I issue it here, it will not get the results in time, right? We have already discussed this. We have to put a load interlock. Now, what happens if I increase the hit time further? If I have a two-cycle hit time, what happens? I cannot issue it here, the dependent. I cannot even issue it in the next cycle, actually. Okay. So that is a not so obvious impact from the hit time. It actually starts affecting your pipeline efficiency. It introduces more and more interlocks like this. Okay. So today's processor, what they do is that they actually speculate that the load is going to hit in the cache. Okay. So the problem is that until and unless the load has looked up the cache, I cannot really say that this instruction is going to get the data in time, even after the interlock stops. Okay. So clearly that, as I said, I cannot issue it here. Okay, because even if the load hits in the cache, it won't get the data in time. Because I'll issue it here, it will read the register file, the execute state will come here. Okay, right? I have to put the execute stage here. So now suppose that I put an interlock bubble here, all right, and issue it here. Okay. And now when I'm issuing this instruction, I'm actually assuming something. What is that? I'm assuming that the load is actually going to hit in the cache. Okay. Then only this instruction can get the value here. So it's a speculation under which I am actually issuing this instruction. If I did not speculate, I would actually have to wait until this cycle to issue the instruction. I wouldn't have issued actually until this cycle. So today's processor actually routinely use this particular type of speculation. And this speculation makes sense because my cache hit rate is fairly high in most cases. It's actually more than 90% in most cases. So I'm going to be correct with a probability more than 0.9 if I do this. Only 10% of time I'm going to be wrong, in which case I'll have to retract this instruction and again issue it later when the load miss actually resolves. Okay. And as you can guess, there are predictors which can improve this speculation even further. Because see, it's just like a branch predictor. Sitting at this particular point, you're asking the following question. If I issue this instruction, is it going to get the data in time or not? It's just a binary question. Okay, right? So it's just like a branch predictor, and you can learn the pattern. Because you can ask the following question that, looking at the history of this load, tell me whether it is likely to hit or miss in the cache. And that's a highly predictable event, actually. So that's the load hit speculation, and that's often used to bridge the impact of long hit times. So how to reduce hit time? So obvious solution is that you should have a small and simple cache, like a direct map cache. That's very simple. Introducing associativity normally increases hit time. Why? Why is that? A two-way associative cache is going to be slower than a direct map cache. Why? Where exactly do we lose the time? So what happens in a direct map cache? I just take the address, calculate the index, and look up the corresponding set, I get the data. That's it, right? What happens in a two-way cache? What do I need to do?
In a direct map cache, still we have to do tag.
Yes, you have to do a tag comparison. I'm sorry. Yes, correct. Of course. You take the index, look up the cache, do a tag comparison, and if it passes, then you take the data, otherwise not, right? What happens in a two-way cache? Two comparisons. And after that? So there is one more thing that you have to do.
Selecting which way.
Yeah, exactly. There is a multiplexing that is involved here. Okay, so this is a comparison. So this is coming from the tag. And this is tag 0, this is tag 1, and you have data 0 and data 1, that you feed into a multiplexer, and the selection of that is going to be a function of these two, right? As you introduce more associativity, this multiplexer is going to get wider, okay? And this is in the critical path. You cannot get the data out without doing the multiplexer. And gradually your latency will increase because of this multiplexer. Because these comparisons are all in parallel, so they don't really eat into your latency. What eats into latency is this one. Okay. The multiplexer gets wider and wider and you start losing latency. So that's why small and simple caches are possible. Right? The second solution is virtual caches. So I've talked about this a little bit in connection with TLB. So virtually indexed, virtually tagged caches are faster than virtually indexed, physically tagged caches. Why is that? So the first one derives its tag and index both from virtual address, and the second one derives its index from virtual address, tag from the physical address. So why are they faster? So compared to physically indexed, physically tagged caches, this is faster. Why is that? Because you have to do a TLB lookup before you can look up the cache, right? And this one doesn't even need a TLB. The entire thing is in the virtual space, right? So you can just do it without a TLB completely. That's what alpha 21264's instruction cache actually did. However, here, so first of all, the virtual, if you have a virtual index, virtual tagged cache, then since you are bypassing the TLB completely, you have to be careful about permissions and security issues. Because the TLB, when the TLB is looked up, it also provides the permission bits, whether you're allowed to access this thing or not. You're now completely bypassing that. So you have to be careful about that. Okay. You might want to extend your cache tags with these particular bits, permission bits and all. Now with virtually indexed physically tagged cache, there is some other problem. So let's try to look at that. So what we're doing here is that we have the virtual address, block offset, index, and tag. We're taking this index and looking up the cache, right? Okay. That's a virtual index cache. Right? Now, what if there are two processes that are sharing a particular page, right? And so these two pages will have the same physical address, right? Because they're sharing it, but they may have two different virtual addresses. These may be two different virtual pages belonging to two different processes that are sharing a physical page. Okay, all right? So one process accesses it with VA1, the other one with VA2. So clearly they will access two different cache blocks within the cache. Okay, all right? But they are supposed to be pointing to the same physical page because they are sharing it. So now the problem is that one process may modify this particular cache block, other one may read a stale value from this cache block. So this is called a synonym problem. Because these two are supposed to be synonyms of each other, but that invariant is not maintained. So this problem arises only in virtually indexed caches, not otherwise. So how do you solve this problem? How do you make sure that these two virtual addresses actually have the same index bits? Then you're done. So essentially the solution is that whenever two processes want to share a page, their virtual addresses should be picked in such a way by the operating system such that their index bits are exactly same. Then they will map to the same cache block index and we'll have no problem. So how to make that happen? So if you look at the way the translation is done, let's suppose this is my page offset. Okay. And that has to be identical in both. Because we say that the page offset doesn't change in the translation. Okay. The problem is with these bits. We need to make sure that these bits are identical. Then you're done. Okay. So depending on your cache architecture and depending on your virtual memory architecture, virtual address space size, number of these bits may vary. Okay. So let's suppose that there are k such bits. Okay. So what the operating system does is that it divides the entire virtual address space into 2 to the k bits. Right? And whenever two processes request two virtual pages to be shared, the operating system will pick these two virtual pages from the same bin. So that will make sure that these k bits are exactly same. And these are called colors. These 2k colors are assigned to the virtual address space. And the pages are picked with the same color. So this particular scheme is called page color. Okay. That solves the synonym problem. Third solution for reducing heap time is pipelined cache access, where access latency still remains unchanged, but the throughput improves. Pipeline the cache access so that you can, every cycle you can feed something to the cache. Although the final data may come out much later, but your throughput increases, the number of accesses that you finish for any time. Another solution is wave prediction. So this is this was used in MIPS 4300 and Alpha 2.264. So essentially here the idea is that the cache lookup time becomes so high that you cannot accommodate it within your cycle time. So what you do is you make a prediction. You ask a predictor to tell me which way should have the data instead of actually looking up the ways. Right? So that's the way prediction. 2.264 actually went ahead and did even more than that. It said that, well, I'm not going to compute the index even from the address. I'm going to ask the predictor to tell me the line also, which set will have the data. All right, so you access the data in the background, you actually keep doing the traditional thing and verify. Of course, your prediction will go wrong sometimes, in which case you'll actually use the final data that came out of the actual access. Another solution for reducing heap time is pseudo-associativity. So let's try to understand what this is. So in a two-way cache, usually what do? We take the index, look up both the ways, take the tags from both the ways, make two comparisons, and decide based on that what needs to be done. So, so as we said just now, that because of the multiplexing between the ways, it may be slower than direct match cache access. So what pseudo-associativity does is, it actually doesn't do this. It has a two-way cache, but accesses one way first. Okay. If you hit, you're done. You have done a cache lookup at the speed of a direct map cache, essentially. Okay. If you miss, then you look up the other way. Okay. And if you hit in this way, what you will do is that you'll swap these two lines. Okay. Because every time you look up this way first. So this is called pseudo-associativity. On average, it increases your access latency. Yeah, so you have two hits now. One is a fast hit, other one is a slow hit.